Italy, where she matriculated in 2011. She graduated with an honors degree in philosophy and a master's degree in creative writing from the University of the Free State. She was the 2017 winner of the AFBOB poetry competition in the Afrikaans section for her poem. I cannot pronounce that without butchering it, so I shall not. I'll let her pronounce it to you for you guys. I could attempt, but my attempt would be terrible. So out of respect, I will not. And that is her debut anthology. It's 80 Cruz from 2020.
Eddie Cruz.
80 Cruz.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, look at me. Is her debut poetry anthology. And it was published in 2020 by Quella. It received a Sala Award for first time published author. And her second anthology, Kindale, was published in March.
Tenderly.
Kinderle. Okay, published in 2024. So this year, okay, I'm gonna be on the lookout. It was published this year by I don't, what's I'm unfamiliar with this publishing house.
Quellery,
Quellery.
Quellery,
Quellery.
under Media 24 Books.
Okay, Quellery under Media 24. Okay, I'll be on the lookout. And how the procedure for the night? I will read a poem and I'll hand over to you, Lynthia, to do your thing for about 30 minutes or so. And then we'll take a 5 minute, no, we'll have questions after your reading, and then we'll take a 5 minute breather and come back for an open mic session. And for tonight, I will be reading from Kate Tempest, Let Them Eat Chaos. This is the collection. Okay, it's my camera's not focusing, but the collection is Let Them Eat Chaos by Kate Tempest, and it is a very, very long poem, but I'm just going to read 2 pages of it, the beginning. Picture a vacuum, an endless and unmoving blackness, peace, or the absence at least of terror. Now, in amongst all this space, see that speck of light in the furthest corner, gold as a pharaoh's death box. Follow that light with your tired eyes. It's been a long day, I know. But look, watch as it flickers, then roars into fullness, fills the whole frame. Blazing a fire you can't bear the majesty of. Here is our sun, and look. See how the planets are dangled around it and held in their intricate dance. There's our Earth. Its blueness soothes the sharp burn in your eyes. Its contours remind you of love. That soft roundness, the comfort of ocean and landmass. Picture the world. Older than she ever thought she'd get, she looks at herself as she spins, arms loaded with the trophies of her most successful child. The pylons and mines, the power plants shimmer in her still cool breath. Is that a smile playing across her lips, or is it a tremor of dread, the sadness of mothers as they watch the fate of their children unfold? And with that, welcome, Lynthia, everybody. Lynthia, the floor is yours.
Thank you, thank you. Oom Di, gaan ek net begin of moet ons nog iets sê?
No, you go ahead. We can just say what we like in between.
Okay. So ek begin met ontheemding. My ma se 'n babie gebore in 'n Makoland kind. Ek toe dit Vrydag is in Koeroepoort blou en koud in 'n Makoland se kind. My ma suurdeeg brood en namastap, koulag en kit, oukie bin bersig mens. Sy kan 'n namma tel tot 10. Toe ek nou die regterry toe kom ek net by 3. Sy het getrek en vir Kimberley my saam met haar gevat. As ek terug gaan sien ek my pappa huisie maatjies, hulle het almal kinders, vry nou en dan getroude mans. Ek het gesien wat armgatigheid aan mens kan doen. Word 'n mak hou kou waarin mans jou afknou. Ek is toe vir Kimberley 'n huister gemaak. Ek kon nog nooit soos hulle praat. As ek in Springbok kom, is ek te stad in Kimberley te Nama. My ma sê, haar ouma was 'n Nama vrou. Die groot mense het onder die skerm gesit en hulle taal gepraat. Die kinders weggejaag, want dit was 'n groot mens taal. My ma ken baie antwoorde. Sy is 'n goed beleese vrou. Maar sy het nie antwoorde as ek vra wie die god van die Namas is nie.
So we're going to read, alternatively, I'll read the translations that I've done in the past of the poems. Just to say that I first discovered Lynthia through LitNet, where she had a couple of poems on the web. And I thought, gosh, interesting poems, interesting writer. And as is my wont with other languages, I try and translate them in order to understand them better. Obviously, I can read Afrikaans, but I can, once translated, I have a better sense of, and out of that developed a relationship, because we discovered that we were both Northern Capers. And when Lynthia discovered I had been born in Upington, she said, well, then we're family. So I'm rather glad to be included in Lynthia's family in that way. But also, there's a word in the poem that she's just read called, the word is Weister. So I'm also a Weister, because I lived in Kimberley for 4 years when I was a teenager. Yeah, well, yeah, partly a teenager and before. So I asked her, when I first encountered that in the poem, I asked her to explain it to me. And she said, well, if you're from Kimberley, colloquially, you're said to be from the Wye. So if you're from or live in Kimberley, you're called a Weister, as in Y-S-T-E-R. But we, in the translation, I used a W-H-Y-S-T-E-R, which made it slightly more amusing. Also, Lynthia in the poem mentions Turupoort, and I asked her to explain that, and she said, if you walk out of our neighborhood, Bersig, towards town, you have to go between two kopjes along a narrow road. It is called Turupoort. Here, against one kopje, is the small hospital where I was born. So here's my translation, which I hope bears reasonable resemblance to the original, and it's called Displacement. My mother was born in Nababi, an Amakwilan child, me on a Friday night in Kuruport, blue and cold, an Amakwilan child. My mother is sourdough bread and Nama line dancing, belly laughter and meat, Okip and Bersik people. She can count to 10 in Nama. When I tried the other day, I only got to 3. She left me and headed to Kimberley, took me with her when I go back. I see my doll's house friends. They all have kids. Now and then sleep with married men. I've seen what poverty can do to people, how it becomes a keep you tame cage that men rough you up in. So I was Kimberley'd, made into a Weister. I could never speak like them. When I'm in Springbok, I'm much too city. In Kimberley, too Nama. My mother says her grandma was a Nama woman. The grown-ups sat under the awning and spoke their language, shooed away the children because it was a grown-up's language. My mother knows a lot of answers. She's a well-read woman. But she has no answers when I ask who the god of the Namas is.
Intellektualisme van goed. Ek was moeg van die intellektualisme van goed, moeg van Chelan, moeg van Chopin, moeg van Adorno, siel siek van Horkheimer, moeg van Vakou, Mbembe, Nagel, Chomsky. Ek was moeg van die intellektualisme van goed. Ek wou hardloop. Hardloop die Noord-Kaap al in verby Griekostad, Groblershoop, Appington, Kuimoes, Kakamas, Pofadder, Aggeneys. Ek wou hardloop en hardloop tot in mamma se huis. Tot in die buitetoilet. Tot in Anthony se tik stories van die Here wat kom. Tot in elke vuurvertrek wat nog staan. Kalf het in ons ongeteerde straat stap. Ons ongepluisterde mure my hande oplê en hy dankbaarheid soos die voete van Jesus soen. Ek wou aan die lysie se stories hoor van Ashley wat met die kombers op die dak lê as die son skyn. Ek wou om Piet Oorvals gitaar speel met sy wyn by sy linker tekkie en die tegastompie by die regter een. Ek wou vloek hoor. Na Makoland vloek en Nama musiek. Versier reegbrood ryk. Ek wou baie hoor. Baie lip naai hoor. Voor een God, weet jy, die man is allemaal bloedetter voor God, sê ek jou. Sy mama moes om doodgeleid, dat was daar nou een man erbek wat die wel zijn kost moet gee. Ek wou die bergie dronk oor klauwer vrouwe. Die volke vrouwe hou van die donors huwelik. Goed hou van die huwelik, jy hoor net huwelik nuwe skoene hê, huwelik nuwe banke hê, bly net so gehê besigheid in die man. Wat kry die volke man? Kak. Kak is wat die man kry. Ek wou dit hoor. Net dit. Ek was moeg van die intellektualisme van goed.
So this those two early poems in on Litnet, this was one of them, and the other one was a delightful and warm and generous and lovely poem about her mother. And what attracted me most about this poem was in language they talk about high language and low language and the relationships between the two. In linguistic usage, and I think this has both. And I think it also speaks to cultural dislocation, which is something that I've always felt wherever I've been as an individual. There's certain places that I do feel at home in, but they tend to be small places and very local. So I identified, I think, with the sense of cultural dislocation. Intellectualizing stuff. I was tired of stuff being intellectualized, tired of Celan, tired of Chopin, tired of Adorno, fed up with Horkheimer, tired of Foucault, Mbembe, Nagel, Chomsky. I was tired of stuff being intellectualized. I wanted to run through the whole of the Northern Cape, past Griquatown, Groblershoop, Uppington, Kuimoos, Kakamas, Pofadder, Aggeneys. I wanted to run and run all the way back to my mama's house, back to the outside toilet, back to Anthony's took stories of the coming of the Lord, back to every four roomer still standing, walk barefoot on our unpaved street, lay my hands on our unplastered walls and kiss them out of gratitude like the feet of Jesus. I wanted to hear Auntie Lacey's stories of Ashley, who used to lie on the roof with a blanket when the sun was shining, with his wine next to his left tacky. I wanted to hear Uncle Pete playing his out-of-tune guitar with his wine next to his left tacky, and the butt of a spliff beside the right. I wanted to hear swearing, Namakwalan swearing, and Nama music, smell fresh sourdough bread. I wanted to hear, bye, go fuck yourself. Before one God, you know that man's really a bastard. Before God, I tell you, his ma should have smothered him. Then there'd be one less mouth for welfare to feed. I wanted to hear the Berchi, drunk, complain about women. The fucking women like to fucking get married. They so like marriage. All you hear is marriage, want new shoes. Marriage, want new chairs. Always the same. I want business. And the man? What does the fucking man get? Crap. Crap is what the man gets. I wanted to hear that. Just that. I was tired of stuff being intellectualized.
Loslaten. Die swaar reën het die dag gekom, die getuienis van ons voorouers se trane, die hoop op vrugbare grond. Ja, ons bemin die dag met haar sagte hande wat waters om ons laat drup. Die waters op ons vet besmeerde koppe, die waters op ons manne se vuil klere, die waters op hulle oop arms. Die dag toe ons ons vaskoene uit kan trek en met ons kaal voete die aarde inloop, weg van verdrukking en sweet, weg van swepe en onlus. Ja, ons bemin die dag die reën met allermoontlikhede. Ja, ons lag en slaan ons oë op na die berge, na die God wat die dag vir ons gebring het. Ja, ons bemin die dag.
Release. A heavy rain fell on that day, witness to our ancestors' tears, the longing for fertile soil. Yes, we adore that day with her soft hands that lets water drizzle around us. Water on our fat smeared heads, water on the dirty clothes of our men, water on their open arms. That day we could take off our tight shoes and walk with our bare feet in the earth, free from oppression and sweat, away from whips and unrest. Yes, we adore that day, the rain with all her possibilities. Yes, we laugh and lift up our eyes to the mountains, to the God who brought us that day. Yes, we adore that day.
Skuld. Prime Minister Foster's first attempt to reconcile differences was to suggest that the particular problem of the colored community be left to the next generation. A Brown Afrikaner Speaks, 1971. Ek betaal die skuld af vir my ouers nie. Ek werk die wonde toe wat nou nog bloei met wondgare wat ek by 'n staatsdokter moet loop vra nie. Ek las die goed aan mekaar wat ek die breek gemaak het, maar sok om kry het nie. My tande is die stomp vir groendruiwe wat voor of kerkvaders geëet het nie. My arms gaan nie gebeentes vas of van gefossileerde hart en seer kry nie. Ek gaan nie die massa van my land, my mense op my paar kilogram lyf se rug dra nie. Ek gaan nie breek onder 'n las wat vir my gekies is nie. Ek onderhandel die skietstakings van dompas en domhou oorloë nie. Niemand gaan in my voorstel wat ek vas of reg moet werkie. Ek is nie 'n marionet of naisterie. Ek kies my slagvelde. Ek aanvaar nie hand-me-downs van 'n systeem waarvan ek geen onderdeel was nie. Ek vul nie 'n blokkie in om die bureaukrasie te maak werk nie. Ek is nie in die wieg gelê om geneesmiddels uit te vind vir siektes wat ek nie veroorsaak het nie. Ek kies my beloofde land privaat. Ek is geen aangewese Joshua nie. Ook betaal ek gewoon gin soos 'n Sil Barnard iemand se fucking skuld af by 'n McDonald nie.
So the reference to Saul Barnard and McDonald is that their characters in Darlene Mateer's book Krunge in en Bos, and McDonald is a wood buyer who keeps people who live in the Knysna forest in debt. They're effectively indentured to him. And the central character, Saul Barnard, has to pay off his parents' debts. So that's the reference there. And the epigraph was from A Brown Afrikaner Speaks, and that's the epigraph is the same. It was in English. So I'll just read the poem. Debt. I'm not paying off the debt of my parents. I won't sew up still bleeding wounds with stitches I have to go and ask a state doctor for. I'm not fixing things up I didn't break, but found that way. I've got no taste for unripe grapes eaten by four or church fathers. My arms won't hold on to the bones of fossilized hate and hurt. I'm not going to carry the weight of my country, my people, on the back of my couple of kilos body. I'm not going to break under a burden chosen for me. I don't negotiate ceasefires for Donbas and Stadam conflicts. No one's going to suggest to me the only kind of work I can do. I'm no one's marionette or seamstress. I choose my battlefields. I won't accept hand-me-downs from a system I was not a part of. I don't, where she says a blocky, it's those little square brackets on a form where you put a tick or a cross. So I don't fill in a blocky to make the bureaucracy function. I wasn't born to find a cure for diseases I didn't cause. I choose my promised land on my own. I'm not an appointed Joshua. Also, unlike Saul Barnard, I won't pay off someone else's fucking debt with a McDonald.
Hey, Nikki. Ek hoor hulle het gisteraand 'n boele deur jou brein gepop. Ek hoor hulle wil gehê het en jy wil nie afgee nie. Hulle het gevra jy moet by Pielkop stil staan, maar toe wou jy nie. Ek hoor dis 'n goeie ding. Jy wou al hoe kan jy die child support geld gee vir jou klomp kinders sê. Ek hoor dis goed gemaak so. Vir die trane wat jy ander mense se maas gekos het. Nikki, onthou jy? Ons het langs mekaar gesit in pre-primair.
Do you want to say anything about who Nikki was?
Omdat ek me nou so behind the scenes. Nikki was net 'n maatjie wat ek mee groot geraak het. En die lewe het nie baie mooi vir hom uitgedry nie.
Okay. Hey, Nikki. I hear they put a bullet through your head last night. I hear they wanted and you wouldn't hand over. They asked you to stand dickhead still, but then you wouldn't. I hear it's a good thing. From the get-go, you wouldn't pay the child support money for your bunch of kids. I hear it made things right that way for the tears you cost other people's mothers. Nikki, do you remember we sat next to each other in pre-primary?
Net nog een. Hulle het hom gister sandlak in oorgetrek. Hy klonk Kevin van Annie wat agter die sokkerveld in hy blou houtpie huis ry bly. Die een wat sy lewe verruil het vir 'n 28 chappie. Wat 'n gun in sy rugsak gedra het voor hy die skool in Sandert 7 gelos het. Hy het 5 bullets in sy bors en een in die kop gehad. Sy ma het gevra hulle moenie sy kus in die kerk oopmaak nie. Die bullets het uit 26 sukke ingekom. Daar was 'n gillende ma wat by haar sitkamer uitkom hardloop het, wat dankbaar geraak het dat die bullets nie haar kind wat in die pad gespeel het, soos Suzanne se 4-jarige laasweek getref het nie. Die polisie het gekom, hulle kon niks maak nie, dit was die 6ste geval die man. Die 26 wat geskiet is gekry, hy het nie berou in hom gehad nie. Gesê om by die ranks op te beweeg, moet jy wit bene van die vyand maak. Kevin se pa het gehuil by sy begrafnisie. Met 'n donker bril eenkant gestaan en met bewende hande 'n polmol rooi aangesteek, terwyl sy klong in die aarde se keel afsak.
So the 26s and the 28s are gang members, the particular gangs, and each of the number gangs has particular functions or organizations. Just another one. They covered him over with a sand sheet yesterday, that boy, Kevin, from Annie, who lives in the blue RDP house behind the soccer field. The one who exchanged his life for a 28 tattoo, who carried a gun in his backpack before he gave up school in Standard 7. He had 5 bullets in his chest and 1 in the head. His mother asked them not to open the coffin in the church. The bullets came from a 26's gun. There was a screaming mother who ran through her sitting room door, who was grateful the bullets hadn't hit her child playing in the road, like they did Suzanne's 4-year-old last week. The cops came. They couldn't do anything. It was the 6th case that month. The 26 who did the shooting was caught. He had no remorse in him. Said to move up the ranks, you've got to make bare bones of the enemy. Kevin's dad didn't cry at his funeral. Stood to one side with dark glasses on and with shaking hands, lit a Pall Mall red as his boy slid down the earth's throat.
Hy het gesê ek dra my smile soos 'n kus, het ek gehoor. Hy bedoel kus. En sy oë het vol rou geword. Hy het gesê my keel is 'n graf. My lippe bots soos grond, my tande grafsteen wit, my woorde sandlaken. Sy oë het seer gemaak gelyk. Gesê sy ma moes al sy lyk by die lykhuis uitgaan ken. Sy niggies het al begrafnisklere gaan koop. Net ek alleen sou aftertees hou, het hy gesê. Op die tafel met sy vuiste geslaan. Gesê ek maak van 'n lewendige man die dood met 'n donker bril aan. Gesê ja, dra daai smile soos jy jou all-stars dra. Uitgetrap en klaar.
He said, I wear my smile like a coastline, is what I heard. He meant coffin. And his eyes filled with grief said, my throat is a grave. My lips are dumb like earth. My teeth, gravestone white. My words, sheets of sand. His eyes looked hurt. Said his mother had already been to identify his body at the morgue. His nieces had already been to buy funeral clothes. Said, I will hold a wake afterwards on my own. Banged on the table with his fists. Said, I'm making a living man into death with sunglasses on. Said, yes, wear that smile the way you wear your all-stars, worn out and finished.
Aftertees. Dit was ou Sesedown. Carlton het hom neergesit. Bernice moes klop. Lykie het van haar Black Label gesluk. Dorothy het kom sê man moet vir homself opskep. Sarah moes vir Michael keer wat weer uit die jaartyd wil hardloop. Klas het Lykie se glas omlaat val. Die Here het vir ou Blank gedown. Soos afsak in die grond. Die perde het stil gaan raak en Jason het sonder ophou geklop.
So after tears is what the Irish would call a wake. It's the funeral party after the funeral. And you have to imagine the scene with these characters who are all doing something at this party. And it's om te sê oor Jason, of nie?
Nee, om die, ek het nou iets om oor Jason te sê nie.
After tears. And at the party, there's one group is playing dominoes. So you can hence the opening. After tears. It was double six down. Carlton played it. Bernice had to knock. Lakey took a slug from her Black Label. Dorothy came and said, everyone must dish up for themselves. Sarah had to block Michael, who wanted to run out of the backyard again. Klaas let Lakey's glass fall over. The Lord played a double blank, like 6 feet under. The players all went still, while Jason knocked without end.
Apocalypse. Laat my liggaam vir jou 'n apokalips word. 'N heilige sonvloed. 'N tipe epistemologie van water word soos breitings in wat oopbars, uitbreek, wegsleer. Stort in my jou lewende water, nie eenmalie maar drie, in die bou op bou van rondes. Laat die man uit ons beker drink, terwyl jou heelal in my dors instroom. Maak gravitasiekolke in my kurwes deur my eerste aardse bars. Gryp my aan met jou bestaan. Laat my liggaam vir jou 'n apokalips word.
Apocalypse. Let my body become an apocalypse to you, a holy deluge, become a kind of epistemology of water, like Brayton's, that explodes, erupts, washes away. Pour your living water into me, not once, but three times, going at it round after round. Let the moon drink from our cup while your universe spills into my thirst. Make gravitational vortices in my curves to the explosion of my aorta. Embrace me with your being. Let my body become an apocalypse to you.
Had a law excuse. Jou ma was maar 'n skuurkop. Jou pa jagter vir sy ma se liefde. Jy 'n verslymende stilte in naam, geslag ontoegekend. Jy's teruggepos na jou maker, voor hierdie aarde se gees kon inasem. Voor jou ma jou kon leer van genade, voor jou pa jou kon lief hê met sy preekhart. Sonder sand, sonder klipkoppe grawe. Jy was maar 'n mistkol. Weg voor die kind kon antwoord, voor MTN jou kon charge. Weg voor binnelandse sake van jou kon weet. Slaap. Miskien eendag skiet ek en jy marbles met die engele. Miskien eendag kom die liefde van jou terug. Slaap maar se kind. Here, dra sag my kind.
The title is a French expression, la douleur excuse. It refers to a love that can't be consummated or returned, which I've translated as the exquisite pain. Your mom was just pig-headed, your dad a hunter after his mother's love, you a slimed silence, a name, sex not designated. You've been mailed back to your maker before you could inhale the spirit of the earth, before your mother could teach you about mercy, before your dad could love you with his broken heart. Without sand, buried without a headstone, you were just a missed call, gone before this side could answer, before MTN could charge you, gone before home affairs could know about you. Sleep. Perhaps one day you and I'll shoot marbles with the angels. Perhaps one day love will come back from you. Sleep, mum's child. Lord, carry my child gently.
Kokerboom. There's a bluebird in my heart that wants to get out, but I'm too tough for him, Charles Bukowski. There's a kokerboom in my heart that wil groei, maar sy is te ver van haar grond af. Ek sê, los die groei besigheid, na Makoland toe kos klomp geld. Ek wil by niemand weer geld vra nie. There's a kokerboom in my heart that wil groei, maar ek lei mimosas nat, terwyl kwaai as op die gras val. En die jagse manne wat uit karvensters vlei, die kelners in smoking sections, en kassiere in tops weet nie sy starie. Daar's 'n kokerboom in my hart wat wil groei, maar ek laat haar nie toe nie. Ek sê, hou op. Wil jy ek moet jou familie sien wat die ver van Ryan se graf afstaan nie? Wil jy my still life moet verhoog word? Wil jy ek moet 'n breakdown kry voor my boek se launch? Daar's 'n kokerboom in my hart wat wil groei. Maar selfs as ek wil stil by praat, ek party aande met haar wanneer die huis net asem tee is. Ek sê, ek weet jy dors, ek ook. Dan sit ek haar terug. Sy aanvaar die bietjie bloemwater en glimlag. Ek het haar nog nie so verwaarloos nie. En ons slaap in 'n stad wat nie aan ons behoort nie. Ons vriendskap is geheim. En dis mooi genoeg om 'n vrou te laat huil, maar ek huil nie.
I should say that this poem, Kookaboom, and the previous poem are from, and the rest of the poems we're going to read are from Lynthia's new collection, which was published earlier this year, called Kinderle. That's the book there. And I do highly recommend it. It's worth getting and reading. I mean, I hope one day we'll be able to bring out a slim volume of selected translations of Lynthia's work. But in the meantime, so a kookaboom is the quiver tree. And I presume everyone in the room knows what a quiver tree looks like, but it's a branching species of succulent indigenous to the Northern Cape. And the epigram by Bukowski is the same. Quiver tree. There's a quiver tree in my heart that wants to grow, but she's too far away from her lands. I say, forget about the growing business. Going to Namaqualand costs loads of money. I don't want to ask for money from anyone again. There's a quiver tree in my heart that wants to grow, but I water mimosas until saturated while cigarette ash falls on the grass. And the randy men that whistle from car windows, the waiters in smoking sections, the cashiers in tops, don't know she's there. There's a quiver tree in my heart that wants to grow, but I don't allow it to. I say, stop it. Do you want me to see your family standing nearby Ryan's grave? Do you want my stir life to be increased? Do you want me to have a breakdown before my book launch? There's a quiver tree in my heart that wants to grow. But even though I want to keep quiet, some nights I talk to her when the house is only breathing. I say, I know you're thirsty. Me too. Then I put her back. She accepts a little bloom water and smiles. I've never neglected her in that way. And we sleep in a city that doesn't belong to us. Our friendship is a secret, and it's nice enough to make a woman cry. But I don't cry.
Daai tyd van die maand. Ek geniet die food cravings. Chicken leg and hot wings. Fruit and nut chocolates, droë witbrood. Ek geniet die paisies. Die nuus wat kom met watervalle. Die reuk van Lilette's unscented pads. Die seerpramme soos bomme. Daar's net een spesie wat ek nie kan voor my oë verdra nie. Manne. En ek word van verwag om met hulle te praat. Ek bly met hulle in een huis. Luister na hulle se klas. Hulle is oral, op vlugte en winkels op kampus. Hulle flirt en vra jou nommer. Blykbaar is dit onwettig om hulle iets aan te doen. Tog het hulle nie die memo gekry as dit by ons kom nie. Jy moet met hulle onderhoude voer. Luister as hulle praat en pla. Al wat my beter laat voel is om hulle te dissect. Ek begin gewoonlik by 'n arm, maak frikadelle met hulle lewers, gebruik hulle oë en martinis, so sny en kap en sny ek terwyl hulle in my omtis is. Is jy nog by ons? Nee, jou entitlement keer dat jy agterkom. Ek kap jou trilpap.
That time of the month. I enjoy the food cravings. Chicken lick and hot wings. Fruit and nut chocolates, dry white bread. I enjoy the pimples, the sneezing that comes with waterfalls, the smell of Lilette's unscented pads, the sore breasts like bombs. There's only one species I can't tolerate in front of my eyes. Men. And I'm expected to talk to them. I live with them in one house, listen to their classes. They're all over the place, on flights, in shops, on campus. They flirt and ask for your number. Apparently, It's unlawful to do something to them, yet they didn't get the memo that came to us. You have to converse with them. Listen when they talk and bother. The only thing that makes me feel better is to dissect them. I usually start with an arm, make meatballs with their livers, use them in martinis. So I cut and chop and cut while they're in my space. Are you still here? No. Your entitlement reverses, so you follow behind. I'll chop your dick until soft.
Social distance. Ek het groot geraak. Jou hande kan my nie meer hou nie. Ek skrik nie meer as jy my voor die bors gryp nie. Nie as jy my nagte uit jou huis sit nie. Nie vir jou kil woorde wat my altyd laat huil het nie. Ek het bitter geraak. Jou hart kan dit nie hou nie, nie my verwyte nie. Ook mense in my agterkop dra die woede wat ek dagliks in kweek. Jy drome vir my gehad, Daddy, ek was jou sagste kind. Een wat nooit teë praat nie, nooit terugslaan nie. Die een wat vrede vra, maar Daddy, my hart kon die lewe se gonja vat nie. Ek was nooit sterk soos jy en ek het geknak, my pa. Die breek het om al die jare as heel vermom. Jy hoef nie te sê jy is teleergesteld nie. Die jammer in jou oë as jy my kyk sê dit dagliks wanneer ek jou melk teen jou groen pepkoppie in die garage loop afgee. Daar was distance lank voor COVID.
There's an interesting word in that poem, gonya. Which freely translates as your fate or your destiny or the what life throws at you, as it were.
Yeah, indeed, it is so.
Okay. So I translated. I mean there's no simple direct translation for that, but I you'll see what I came up. Dilevas gonya fatni. Social distance. I have grown up. Your hands cannot. God, what have I done here? Your hands cannot hold me anymore. Sorry, I've grown up. Your hands cannot hold me anymore. I don't scare anymore when you grab me by the chest, not when you kick me out of your home at night, not at your cold words that always made me cry. I've grown bitter. Your heart can't endure it. I'm not to blame how I carry people in the back of my mind. The anger I cultivate every day. My apologies for reading. I'm reading this badly because I've seen a couple of gaps where I missed a word. I'm going to read it again. Hoe sê mens hou? Is this nie hold? Is this om te slaan?
Of, jou hart kan dit nie hou nie. Indio is reg om die.
Ja. Wat sê wat?
Indio is reg. Jou Indio, hart kan dit nie. Ja.
I've grown up. Your hands cannot hold, endure me anymore. Hold me anymore. Endure. Oh God, I'm going to have to correct that. I don't scare anymore when you grab me by the chest, not when you kick me out of your home at night, not at your cold words that always made me cry. I've grown bitter. Your heart can't endure it. I'm not to blame. How can I carry people in the back of my mind? The anger I cultivate every day. You had dreams for me, Daddy. I was your gentlest child, the one who never talked back, never hit back, the one who asked for peace. But Daddy, my heart could not take life's blows. I've never been strong like you. I snapped, my dad. The brokenness disguised itself as whole all the years. You don't have to say you're disappointed. The pity in your eyes when you look at me says it every day when I take your tea with milk. And your green pep cup to you in the garage. There was distance, long before COVID.
Namakulan dorp somer aan ter nagedagte aan Ryan. Die laatmiddag het boom geword. Maar Anthony wat langs aan staan vlieg. En 'n vervallige godsman loop ver agter, wat in dronkenskap van God se liefde getuig en waghou vir sy agter die klipbank pismyt. En die rook in die plakkerskamp rook verby die Shurusdam sing mense wat met vuil overall broeke nog hoop stap stap die appelkoos jam skemer in. Daarom tolweg stak 'n boer se bakkie met eeldand werkers agterop droog. Oom Oupa Teerpad se ou taxi kom staan van self geroes voor die smokkeljard se oog. En toe sien met die dooie klein kind op sit op haar aangeboude stoep. Vanaand hoor ons weer hoe sy die Here verwyd en verraai en roep.
I think you ought to just have say something very quickly and briefly about your friend Ryan, because he is a presence in this reading. He's been mentioned a few times, and particularly here.
Ek en Ryan het bevriend geraak toe ek 10 jaar oud was en hy is 2019 in 'n karongeluk oorlede. Sy dogter was 2 jaar oud en 'n dronk polisieman het in sy kar vasgery en weggery en die man het nou nog sy werk.
Yeah, very sad. Namaqualand town, summer evening. And one of the shadow references of the Afrikaans poem is a poem by N.P.F. van Wyk Lowe called Karoodorp Somerand. Namaqualand town, summer evening, thinking about Ryan. The late afternoon became weed for Anthony standing to one side, whistling. The faithless man is walking far behind, drunkenly testifying to God's love and waiting for his taking a piss behind the outcrop girlfriend. And the smoke from the squatter camp smokes, singing past the sewerage dam workers that with dirty overalls still hope. Step, step into the apricot jam dusk. Far away on the toll road, a farmer's bucky is stuck with calloused hand workers on the back, dry. Uncle Grandpa Tar Road's ancient taxi stands on its own, rusted in front of the smuggler's yard's eye. Auntie Tussie with the dead grandchild comes and sits on a built-on stoop. Tonight we hear her once more, reproaching the Lord and calling to Ryan.
Manne sleutels, sy hou van oopdeure. Maar weet Putin nie, hy sleutel nie. As man uitvind hy sleutel, dan raak man slot.
Earlier, before the start this evening, we were discussing humour and whether who had written about humour. These two poems were originally appeared in stanzas, and what I loved about them was the darkness of their humour, what in Yiddish would be known as bitter gelachter, bitter laughter, which I think is such a crucial psychological mechanism in human affairs. It's what often keeps us balanced and human in the face of all manner of adversity. And so these two little poems come out of that space. Man as key. Men are keys. She likes open doors. But he must not know he's not the key. If a man finds out he's the key, he becomes a lock.
Steak and kidney pie. My ma's lief vir my. Maar as my niere ingee en sy is 'n geskikte kandidaat en my pa vra vir 'n steak en kidney pie op 'n Vrydag aan, sal sy haar niere met haar kale hande uit haar rug gril om gaar te maak en bloed kyk hoe hy die pie opeet, terwyl hy Channel 171 kyk en sê die kos was te min.
Jammer dat ek lag hier. Steak and kidney pie. My mother loves me, but if my kidneys fail and she is a suitable candidate and my father asks for a steak and kidney pie on a Friday evening, with her bare hands she'll dig her kidneys out of her back and cook them well, and bloodied watch him eat up the pie while watching Channel 171 and saying, the food wasn't enough.
Moedersdag.
Are we going to read that one as well?
Ja, Andy.
Okay, well, this will be the last poem then.
Moedersdag. Jy word stiller sulke dae, Daddy, van fout met mamie se kos, skeel vir kaal oor die bakkie nie reg gewas is nie. Er is geen kliphard in die garage, gesaag, geboord tussenin. Mamie try. Sy try brandsteel soos sy maak, sy try, Daddy. Jou tee drink jy met 'n leë hart, leeg soos jou planne wat jy gehad het vir die vrou in wie se pram jy gedrink het en wie se baal jy gegroei het nou is. Jy het my vertel, ek weet sy was rots. Vrou alleen haar 5 kinders grootgemaak, na julle pa se gees rig op die aarde gedry het. Ek het jou gesien hy Saterdagoggend, Daddy, jy het egter die buitetoilet gaan huil. Jou hande oor jou oë gehou toe dit baie sê tyd was. Jy hou haar uit die foto bo in jou kas, is al wat jy van haar oor het. Jy was bly die laaste Easter toe sy by ons was, jou oë het gelag. Maar haar liggaam het opgepak voor haar gees kon. Sy het ons name vergeet, neppies gedra, nooit weer die VGK kerk se klok gelei nie. Mami, sê jy het stil geraak toe jy laas by haar grondhuis was. Siska was bang jy soek troos in 'n breinbottel. Ek sien jy word stil, Derry, op sulke dae. Ons weet jy het 'n hart wat die mond toe loop. Ek weet jy treur, Derry, maar jy maak jou garage deur oop en boor en saag en timmer tot die geluide jou hartsherinneringe doof maak. Maar moenie fout vind met mamie se kosie, Derry. Sy try, mamie, try. Ons is nog hier. Ons bring vir jou tee en jou groen koppie en verstaan jou stilte op sulke dae.
So I think it helps to understand the characters. Daddy is Lynthia's father and Mummy is Lynthia's mother and Carl is Lynthia's brother and Siska, who is a writer in her own right, is Lynthia's sister. And I think one of the things that I really like about this particular coalface that Lynthia works poetically is it examines and interrogates and looks into the way families operate, all the psychological complexities of families and the individuals in families, and how the individuals all interact. And there are quite a few poems in that particular line of poetic exploration. Mother's Day. You go quieter on such days, Daddy. Find fault with Mummy's food. Scold Carl about the bucky not being washed right. Radio Sondergrens are blasting out loud in the garage. Sawing, drilling in between. Mummy tries. She tries to make brown stew like she did. She tries, Daddy. You drink your tea with an empty heart. Empty like the plans you once had, now are for the woman who, from whose breasts you drank, in whose womb you grew. You told me I knew she was a rock. Raised her 5 kids all by herself. after your father's soul turned its back on the earth. I saw you that Saturday morning, Daddy. You went and cried behind the outside toilet. You held your hands over your eyes when it was time to say bye. You keep her ID photo in the top of your cupboard. It's all you have left of her. You were happy that last Easter when she was with us. Your eyes laughed, but her body packed up before her mind could. She forgot our names, wore nappies, never again rang the NGK church bell. Mummy says you fell silent when last at her home, home in the ground. Siska was scared you were looking for comfort in a brown bottle. I see you go quiet, Daddy, on such days. We know your mouth won't let your heart speak. I know you're mourning, Daddy, but you open your garage door, drill and saw and nail until the noise deafens your heart's memories. But don't find fault with Mummy's food, Daddy. She tries. Mummy tries. We're still here. We bring you tea in your green cup and understand your silence on such days. No, two, this us. That's the lot.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Douglas and Lynthia. Can everybody unmute and give Lynthia and Douglas a big round of applause? This is the only way we feel like we're human in this virtual platform. That was really, really interesting to listen to. Interesting to listen to as someone who doesn't even speak Afrikaans. I felt like the images that were being created felt very familiar. I think because I come from a rural area and they all felt like these small pieces of rural life. And I really enjoyed that. But I'd like to open the floor for questions. If anybody has a question or a comment for Lynthia and Douglas, this is your chance. And maybe whilst people think, I have a question for you, Lynthia. How do you feel about your work being translated? Since this was like a translingual type of reading.
I never thought about translations or my work being translated before I met Douglas, or like I call him Umdi, before I met Umdi. And we started emailing each other. And I saw his love for words and how he treats my work as if it's his own, even though it's not his own words, and the respect he has for language. And it's like when your poem gets translated, it's like it just goes into a new world and other readers can read it. And if you asked me before I met Umdi, I would have said, I don't think my work could be translated. But then I met Umdi, and now I'm glad that my work has been translated, because now other people can see my small part of the world and how my life looks in the Northern Cape.
All right. Awesome. Thank you, Lynthia. Jacques, the floor is yours. You have a question.
I'm so deeply moved by your work, Lynthia, and I'm now confused. I don't know whether to ask my question in English or Afrikaans.
Well, I'll answer in Afrikaans. You can ask in English.
I felt wonder as I listened, and I wonder how. You know, I hear poets talk about running away from intellectualism. By and large, we don't. We talk about it. What is it? Urgency? Is it discipline? Is it a combination of the two that makes it possible for you to write so close to the bone, so close to the source, because you really, you manage, you one can hear in the work that you've read and that you've thought, it's not clever, it's very raw and full of experience. How do you do it? How do you stay so close to that source? I'm really in awe of your work.
Jack, ek dink, en ek gaan dit almekaar sê, my ma is 'n groot karakter in my lewe, en my ma glo, as ons is drie kinders, en as jy by haar hek kom, moet jy jou hele grade, jou hele geleerdheid, jou hele education, moet jy by die hek los, want 'n kind het nie 'n sê in haar huisie. So jy gaan nie met slimheid by haar kom nie, want sy is alleen reg, sy is die ouer. En ek dink dis omdat ek sulke mense in my lewe het wat 'n streep trek en sê, los jou intellektualisme, hier is ons net mens. En hier gaan ons net mens wees. En dit maak dat jy kan daai intellektualisme een kant skuif en skryf soos jou mense praat, hoe hulle klink, hoe hulle lyk. Ek dink dis wat my op die aarde hou, of plat op die aarde hou.
Can I have a quick
yeah.
butt in there? Again, it's an interesting thing because the whole thing of high language, low language, because Lynthia, as you rightly point out, employs a lot of what is easily cast as low language, but it actually isn't, because it's all in the pursuit of high ideas. The poems operate on a seemingly easily entered literal surface, narrative surface. But actually, what the act of translating has shown me is that the low language is in pursuit of high ideas. That there's a very rich vein of intellectual argument going on in the back of the poems, a lot of reference to the Afrikaans tradition itself, a lot of reference to other writers, not grandly foregrounded, but certainly there. So it makes for interesting and rich disjunctions and combinations. I don't know if that makes any sense.
I think, and also the voices, the variety of voices, because there's a strong vein of feminism, and at the same time, let's call it that, and at the same time, you know, you give a voice to the Bach who says that the man only gets crap in the marriage, and so it's like other voices come to life in the poems, and that's part of what makes them so wonderful. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Jacques. Is there anybody else in the room who'd like to ask a question, make a comment? This is your opportunity. You just put up your hand. Or is everybody good? Is everybody happy? I'll take this to mean people are happy. People are good. Douglas, how did you feel with Lynthia? I asked her how she felt about being translated. How was the translation? How was the act of translating for you?
Translation is always a compromise. There's simply no escaping that. The inheritance of the two languages is quite startlingly different, but there are points of there are a lot of shared points between the two languages. Intriguingly, if you look at English 1,000 years ago, it looks a lot like Dutch. And in fact, very critical components of English grammar and language derive from early European languages in the Dutch region and from the islands off the Dutch coast. So there is that. But for me, Gosh, I mean, she's very generous, but what I find is whenever I read the translations, I see where I have to carry on working on them. There are little gaps and things that I could get better. And for me, what I have to resist in me is being the writer that I am, and more trying to channel the voice that Lynthia is. And that's an interesting process. It's a general truth of translation, and it's a very enriching process, I find. I think translation is something that every writer should get into to some degree, because it teaches you an enormous amount about language and about writing.
Yeah, I feel like translation is so hard. And when I was listening to one of the poems, I think it was the second poem that you guys read, somewhere it says, Ek is moeg. And in my understanding, my Afrikaans is severely limited. But what I take that to mean is a more colloquial fed up, as opposed to the used tired in the poem. So things like that, the kind of negotiations that you have to make are they, what do you kind of choose? Do you choose the rhythm of the poem? Do you choose the meaning for the poem? Do you choose the voice of the speaker of the poem? Kind of those negotiations are hard ones.
And there are 100 compromises that you have to make. Mm-hmm. And essentially, my own practice is trying to remain as true to the original as possible without neglecting too many opportunities that present themselves in the new language. Because the poem ultimately in the new language has to function as an effective poem in the new language. So, and to do that, you have to make compromises. You have to be, in a way, slightly untrue to the original in places. In the Namaqualand poem, there are crucial rhymes in the Afrikaans, which I can't get in without compromising the original. I mean, I've tried, I've worked at it, and all of the options just were not good enough. They weren't close enough to the original poem. So, you know, translating has been described as a form of betrayal. And in one sense, it's not wrong, but in another sense, you're a taxi driver. You're carrying a passenger from one side of the road to the other. And I find it enriching. It teaches me so much about Lynthia. It teaches me about Afrikaans. So I'm gaining in the whole process. I learn, I keep learning, and how to remain young, keep learning.
Thank you, Douglas. Julien, am I saying that right? Julien, the floor is yours.
Can you hear me at the moment?
I can hear you.
Alrighty, super. I'm just not sure always about the technology. Okay, so I had two questions, but then your question and Douglas's answer actually explained much of what I had in mind. And it's interesting that Douglas actually refers to some of it as compromises. I suppose I'm asking it because even times when I've tried to translate some of my own work, I run into trouble. And it might be because the kind of language that I then use, I think what I'm trying to say is it links to my second question, where the language that I use might actually be so idiosyncratic, so subjectively in my of my world or of the way my mind works, and that then I may make it very difficult for people to understand the poem in the first place, let alone in translation. And that links to the question that I wanted to ask Lynthia, where she mentioned that the way the family setup works and the mom, dat jou ma die persoon, jy weet, basis verwag dat wanneer jy thuis is, om op 'n sekere manier te op te tree, te praat, te reageer, dat mens nie met eiers by die huis aankom nie. Maar is daar oomblikke, Lynthia, wanneer jy op 'n ander manier begin dig en iets wat dan vir jou sê, nee, nou is jy nie getrou aan jou eie siel of jou eie binnegoed nie. En dat jy dit dan weer terugvorm na iets wat trouer is aan jou eie aard.
Ek dink dis altyd vir my iets om mee te sukkel, want ek het een keer vir 'n digter, hulle het my gevra vir 'n dig vir 'n digbundel, 'n gedig vir 'n digbundel. En hy het my gestry, die redakteur, dat my taalgebruik hier reg is, en ek het vir hom gesê, vandat ek graad 1 was tot in matriek, het ons nooit 'n kort verhaal of enige literatuur gedoen in geriep Afrikaansie. En ek het gevoel as ek hierdie boeke in geriep Afrikaans skryf wat ek wil hê, nie moet ek dit self skryf. Maar daar kom 'n dag waar jy soms dink, nou, wanneer skryf jy vir jouself en sit jy nie nou te veel op jou skouers nie. Maar ek dink, omdat ek so lief is vir afluister en mense afluister, kan ek nie anders as om getrou te wees aan wat vir my gesê word. Want ek het, en nou praat ek uit, ek het soms gesien mense prys my poesie vernuf, en dan is dit eintlik net 'n mens in my lewe wat het gesê het, wat ek gedink het net alledaags is. So ek dink om getrou te bly aan die mense, maak dat jy bietjie so die akademie een kan skuif. Want ek meen, ek dink maar net, ons het genoeg gedigte oor die akademie en oor intellektualisme. En ek het gevoel dat ek moet 'n Noordkap stem gee in die Afrikaanse poesie.
Oké, ja, ek hoor jou. En dan, dit laat my besef, ja, ek moet maar net aan my eie manier uitwerk. Want partykeer is my grein om so 'n bietjie intellektueel te wees. Dit was op 'n manier my oorlewing. So, ja. Ek is nou maar weer 'n ander mens in 'n ander omstandigheid, en daarom moet ek seker trou wees daaraan.
Maar dis moeilik om die twee ook te skei. Want ek dink dan net byvoorbeeld aan, ek het een keer iets gesê, en 'n meisie van Kakamas hier in die Noordkap was by, en sy het vir my gesê, ag, gaan tog universiteit gat. En ek moes bietjie terugstaan. Ek moes bietjie terugstaan en dink, okay, dalk moet jy jou nie so kom slim hou hierdie.
Dankie vir dat jy antwoord.
All right. Can I just,
Mandra, can I
say something?
Can I just say something? Lynthia Cheslin Dragoene was binne die huis, en hy is nou weg. Maar het gesê ek moet gaan. Dankie Lynthia vir 'n great aand.
Ai, en ek is bly was hier.
Thank you, Douglas, for reading that for me. Lynthia, I really love debt. I really love that poem. I love how it sounded in the Afrikaans. It's a shame that I can't, like, when I sit in on a reading in a different language, you sort of wish that you could speak the language, because you feel like you're missing out so much. And I just really loved how it sounded in my ears. Are there any other questions before we take a little bit of a break and let everybody take a drink or have a little bite or something? Okay, so there are no more questions. Lynthia, Douglas, thank you so much. We'll take a 5-minute break and come back for an open mic session.